Welcome to Harmony Talk, a podcast about dreamers and doers, artists, authors, inventors, entrepreneurs like our guest today, people who had a dream, fulfilled it, and tell us how they got there, especially the moment they knew there was no turning back. I'm Lisa Champeau, and this show is sponsored by A.M. Skyer, a third-generation family insurance business started in 1920. And my guest today is Travis Rivera, founder of Black & Brass Coffee Roasting Company, a business that started with one small brick-and-mortar building in 2016 in the Poconos, and today, 7 years later, is a national brand found on grocery shelves, online, and in niche settings where Travis customizes his offerings, makes exclusive blends for special customers such as nonprofits. Hi, Travis. Glad to have you with us today.
Hello. Thank you so much for having me.
Now, you and your wife, Kathleen, were featured on the HGTV show Self-Made Mansion. And back then in 2021, the host, Clinton Kelly, said, "You have grown your part-time business into a national company, quote, pulling in $5 million a year." That's dollars we're talking about. That's a remarkable rate of growth in a very short period of time. And I know, and you have said this before, that you didn't start out as a coffee maker. You were a carpenter, a self-described handyman. So how did that evolve into coffee making?
That's a great question. At my core, I always was an entrepreneur. So even as a carpenter, I would go and do the work. But at the end of the day, I still had to sell the product. I still had to negotiate prices. I still had to come up with a strategy that would ultimately lead to a successful business. The last year I worked as a carpenter was actually the most success I had ever experienced.
As a carpenter?
As a carpenter, yeah. The last year I worked as a carpenter was my greatest year ever. And I had developed a niche market at that point, actually building gardens, custom raised beds, custom fencing. It was those skills and even some of those materials that I used to literally build the countertops in our first brick and mortar.
Yeah, I think I read that you built your countertop from one of the coffee roasting crates or something.
That's right. I built the furniture, essentially. The tables were built, were reused doors, and these great old Victorian doors that we flattened out. Parts from the crate that the roaster came in, I actually used, including the screws. It's this great lesson on leveraging every skill that you develop over the course of your life, whether it's literally swinging a hammer or learning how to write or learning how to speak publicly. All these skills that I had developed and curated led to the culmination of the most successful business, which is Black & Brass. At my core, I love coffee. And so it's very easy to strive to create the best coffee.
Absolutely. And we're going to talk about coffee beans in just a few minutes. But in the early days, you said you had your best year ever as a carpenter. So somehow you veered towards coffee. You left the carpentry and veered towards the coffee. So what made you do that? I mean, you weren't that successful in the very, very beginning with the coffee business.
That's a great question. My original plan was that if Black & Brass made $5 at the end of the year and all the bills were paid, I was happy because I was trying to create an asset and something for the community. I believe the myth that it takes 3 years to create a profit when you start a business. Okay. And that's a myth. But my plan was to retire from carpentry in 10 years. So I wanted to create a lot of little businesses. And at that time, I wanted to kind of fill in needs in the community, in the town that I loved, in the town that I lived in. And hopefully, after a decade, I'd be able to dedicate all my time and attention to it. What happened was very quickly, I literally didn't have time to be a carpenter. Black & Brass became so successful so fast, and I saw a direct correlation. The more energy I put into it, the bigger it became. So I put down my tool belt and I went to work building something that became more than just a job. It became a passion. It became a lesson on life and personal growth. I think it's a story of the classic American success that literally starting from nothing and building something that is the American dream story.
Where did you source your coffee in the beginning? Because I know now you get it from a lot of different places.
I always had a clear knowledge of, I want to get my beans from mostly Central and South America. And I had experience in cafes over the course of the years. I always loved coffee. So I would pick up gigs here and there, everything from playing music in a cafe to actually working as a barista part-time, just to socialize, just to get to know people. And over the course of that time, I knew what I liked. I knew what I wanted to create. I knew what I felt other people would appreciate too. So we get primarily Central and South America. I'm particularly biased towards those flavor profiles. They tend to be a little sweeter. They tend to be just fuller bodied. We also use Southeastern Asia and Africa as well.
Now, do you go to these places?
We do. In fact, two of our team members are going to Costa Rica this year. We send our team to go there. We want to be the expert and the authority on what this product is. So we're creating something for the community, but our community spans the planet, the globe. And we actually go and see and get to meet the farmers and see how the product's grown and how it's cared for and how it's harvested. And from my experience, we've been four countries of origin to date. Our track record slowed down during the pandemic, but now we're picking it back up again. But this is arguably the most sustainably processed coffee on the planet. So everything that goes into how it's grown, the soil that it's grown from, the way that each bean is processed and cared for, the measures that they take is truly impressive. So we're very happy. We're very proud to know where this product comes from at its source. And is it a product that we can bring to the end of the chain from meeting a farmer who's out there in 4,000, 5,000, 6,000 foot elevation in these amazing mountain ranges, to going all the way across the line to roasting, to grinding, to brewing, and to serving it in a cup. And that cup is $3. And we know that it took three countries to create that one $3 cup and all of the many hands that go into it. For me, it closes the circuit. It clarifies our place in the world and what it is that we're actually building and creating and what it is that we're actually bringing.
So there are a lot of coffee companies out there these days, and your competition is intense, yet you've been very successful. So how do you negotiate that to the consumer who may say, Black and Brass today or Starbucks?
Right. Well, that's the age-old question for business, right? How do you stand above your competition? For us in this company, I mean, it's quality. It's our service. It's what we bring, our unique profile, flavor, the things that we want to showcase in a bean. Other people agree. It's good to be showcased. So I should say it's challenging not to get caught up in the hype of your own customers, because people tell me all the time, this is the best. You spoiled me. I can't drink anything else. And these are people who used to be fans of all kinds of different companies, large and small. And so you hear that again and again and again. And of course you believe it, but also you don't want to, is this just kindness or is this genuine sincerity? Speaking for myself, I drink it every day.
Mm-hmm. You have, I believe, four actual shops.
Well, you actually have three. So three retail shops. We've got Hamlin, Hawley, and Honesdale.
But you also have this online business and so on and so forth. Is having the shop itself important to you? The actual cafe where people can drink it and you can kind of communicate with them?
It's important to me, yes. It's important to the community more than anything. I think that every community needs a cafe. And I don't think it needs to be Black and Brass. So we've had a lot of success opening up cafes. And this is something that I personally want to build for other entrepreneurs. We know how to build successful cafes. And the next phase in our business is building that for other people that would like to run their own Black and Brass and serve Black and Brass coffee.
Oh, so you're thinking about franchising or?
Yeah, we want to build Black and Brasses across the nation and give other entrepreneurs an opportunity to run a Black and Brass, essentially. We have our formula and our recipe and our tried and true strategy. But at the base of it all is this product, is this fresh roasted premium product that we can produce.
So making coffee is one thing, and you seem to have excelled at that. But managing a business, it sounds like you're really working hard to do that. I mean, you're managing employees, and what are some of your strategies there?
That's an excellent question. I mean, I think essentially you're the only one that can answer every urgency. At the end of the day, every crisis, every question needs to be answered. So I would say the number one thing that you need to do is keep things in perspective. I mean, what are you doing this for, right? And so number one is you're creating value. You're creating a solution. For me, at my core, I'm a creator. And that's my strength and that's my weakness. So I'm very, very good at creating, at building, and it fuels me. The maintaining aspect of once you've got something great, you just continue. So that's where you need a team. You need management skills. A lot of entrepreneurs have it backwards. They think, you know, they get into the business because they want to be the boss, or they have some authority complex, or they're driven by all of these reasons. But one thing that they have to understand is that they are in the business of service. And no matter what kind of business it is, you serve everyone in your company, from your team to your customers, and you serve the community at large. So we could have a business that doesn't have any brick and mortar, that doesn't have any physical space, and we could just sell coffee across the nation, across the world. But to have a physical space circles back to, what are you doing? Well, you're in service. And so before anyone gets into business, ask yourself, are you a giver or are you a taker? Because if you're getting into business because you want to be the boss, be the authority, make lots of money, those are strategies of the latter. And understand that you've got to give a whole lot more than you're going to get. You've got to give a whole lot more attention, time, patience, everything that you want to create, you must give tenfold. And this is why it's so challenging to train and hire managers. Because typically the type of person that wants to be the boss is exactly the type of person who shouldn't be. The person that does what needs to be done because they understand that they're building something greater than just wasting time waiting for the shift to end. That's the person that's in charge, the person who's accountable, the person who has authority, not because of the outfit or the title, but because of their knowledge, because they have an understanding of what it is that we do here. And what do we do? We serve. We serve every single person that comes through that door and every single person that works by our side. And every single time we create something, it is our duty and our responsibility to leave that better than when we arrived.
Was there ever a moment when you said, oh, this is too much, forget it? What was the biggest obstacle you faced?
Many moments, and sometimes on a daily basis. I had heard years ago that the number one reason why business fails is because the entrepreneur quits. Number one reason. And when I heard that, I became so cocky.
I'm not going to quit. Not me, right?
I'm unstoppable. But then you get to a point where you realize, okay, I've developed a certain set of skills. I can dedicate a fraction of this time to somebody somewhere else and leverage these skills to build their vision tenfold. You know, you wonder, what's the next level? So what are you doing it for? What is it that you're trying to build? When I started, I had a checklist of goals and I thought it would take me at least a decade, if not two decades, to accomplish. And it took me 4 years.
So you had a list. You made a list.
I had a list. Yeah.
And that probably helped you, I would assume, in a way that you had something you could, you know, attach your activities to, so to speak, when you were kind of feeling down.
Absolutely. But to go back to your question, what were some of the hardest things that I faced? This is something that so many are going to relate to. The hardest thing that we faced, number one, was the pandemic, followed by the collapse in the supply chain, followed by the Great Resignation, followed by inflation. So to a certain extent, anyone that's still in business, especially if you're relatively small, you should be very proud. Commend yourself, no matter what business you are in, even if you're in coffee and you're a competitor, you know, you should be very proud, because those four things, the pandemic, the collapse in the supply chain, the Great Resignation, and inflation, were enough to cause any of the most successful entrepreneurs pause to consider, should I quit? And what's going to get me out of bed in the morning? And when you're responding to urgencies day after day after day, it's very easy to get lost in the static. And it's your job as the leader to be able to navigate through these waters, regardless of whether it's calm or stormy.
What pulled you out of it? What kept you going? What got you out of bed in the morning?
Well, service. It's the fact that, you know, I'm not doing this for myself. I'm doing this for a greater good. I'm building something. So what you have to know what you're driven by. Me personally, I want to create something that's going to exist 100 years from now. I want to create something that I don't see the final product of. I want to leave the world better than when I arrived. It's very difficult to do that when I was in my 20s and broke. In order to make the world a better place, for me, my journey is, okay, I need to increase my circle of influence. And that starts with accountability, being accountable for your life and your actions and what you do when you wake up in the morning. But very quickly, starting a business is like, it becomes a life of its own, an organism of its own. And there are so many people that put so much work into this, that show up on a daily basis, or customers that have been with us since day one, who really love our product, to those same people who say, I can't drink anything else. I have a responsibility to each and every single person that has put their heart into this thing, even on a small level, That's one major motivation for me is who does it affect beyond myself? Am I contributing more positivity, more good than not?
Well, it's a lofty goal to leave the world a better place and certainly a respectable one. Do you feel that the farmers play a part in that too? In other words, the ones you deal with in Costa Rica and so on, are you helping to make their lives better as well?
Absolutely. I mean, because they're creating something for which we're not only find value in, we're transporting it across the ocean. You have examples of entire economies from coffee, you know, this incredible agricultural crop. The same with any farm community. Does it improve their lives that there's a need for this product? Absolutely. I mean, this is what they do. And it's created a economic opportunity for them that otherwise wouldn't be there. And in some cases, like our Costa Rica farm, the owner of that farm built the medical facilities, built the educational facilities. There's so many opportunities for charities and wildlife, so much good that goes into this commerce. And it's regulated in a legal way too. I mean, let's be real. I mean, certain companies, South America, their cash crop wasn't always something that's as ubiquitous as well. Just as coffee is just kind of such a staple of our life and has been for so many
centuries, really.
It's almost like we're carrying the torch for something that's such a part of our humanity. It's a modern humanity, you know? It's more like we're joining into the story rather than we're contributing, but we're contributing in a small way to something that's, again, much larger than ourselves.
I know that you're originally from California, and I don't know how you got to the Poconos. I do know, though, that you married Kathleen, who ran a tea store, a tea and bookstore. Isn't that correct? Loose Leaf Pages.
Yeah.
So she was selling tea and you were selling coffee, sort of a yin-yang kind of thing, and you got together. Did you meet her here? How did you get here?
I met her here. I came out to help build my mother a home. I was a carpenter. And so I was living in the Sierra Nevadas in California. I was going to college. I was just kind of aimless. And she needed my help. She said, why don't you come out here and try it? Now, I had visited before. I fell in love with the area. I could tell you that story. It's a wild, serendipitous story.
How about the short story? Because it sounds really interesting.
Short story, I took a road trip. I was heading to Alaska, 30 miles from the Canadian border. And this was weeks into our trip. It was the morning of. We pulled over to use the restroom. And we found out that the country was shut down. It was September 11th, 2001. So we're not going to Alaska. We had backpacks and hatchets and the whole thing. My stepfather said, why don't you check out my family in Pennsylvania? So we drove out to Pennsylvania and we ended up meeting his in-laws. And they said, why don't you take a hike? We got lost and ended up in this old sugar shack, took some pictures. Life went on. I went back to California. Years later, my mom says, hey, we have some land. Why don't you come out and help us build the house? Guess what was in the backyard? Sugar shack.
Really?
Yes. That sugar shack, which we stumbled on because we were lost in the woods. Because, you know, coming from California, I was from L.A. You don't just say go that way and there's trees. No, we stumbled on a building and took pictures of it. And it was one of those crazy experiences. Years later, when I saw it, and again, we were heading to Alaska. So years later, one of the businesses I started was Sugar Mountain Farms. I threw my hat into the ring for farming. I had garlic and cabbage and chickens and a couple of goats. I had remodeled the sugar shack to be housing these animals. So if you had told me back then on my way up to Alaska as a teenager,
you'd be a farmer in Pennsylvania.
Yeah. Yeah. In that spot when we got lost.
In that sugar shack, right. But anyway, fast forward. So somehow you met Kathleen.
I met Kathleen, my wife. She was working as a server. She was working crazy long hours, saving up because she was going to move to Philadelphia. And I met her a month or two before she was set to move. And she stopped all her plans and we fell in love and ended up, we had a coffee business. She had a tea business. And now we have two lovely daughters together.
That's wonderful. I have to ask you about the HGTV show, Self-Made Mansion. I know that you got a lot of publicity out of it for sure. And you got a house too. Is that correct?
Actually, the house came first. And that's how they vetted us for the show. A little reality television magic.
So he showed you a house that you actually already had bought?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And they showed us other houses that other people still lived in. It was kind of one of those awkward things where we're like, oh, you know, this house, we got to see something negative about it, knowing that these people are still in our community.
Oh, my goodness.
So I got an email and I thought it was fake. I said, all right. And I kind of sent them a letter and they said, you're perfect. You know, and we had an interview. It was a video interview. And we basically were auditioning for this show, even though they reached out to us. But the criteria was you had to buy a home within the last year. It had to be a large home. And this, the home that we bought, is it's got this history of entrepreneurialism. The previous owners were all very successful entrepreneurs. And of course, it's gorgeous and beautiful. And so they came and filmed it. And we had 3 days to do our normal daily lives and actually run the business to also film this show where we had to come in and be surprised. Wow, look at this house that we live in.
Well, you did a good job. I did see a clip of it.
I mean, it was one of those things too where they said, and cut. And I said, well, wait a minute now. I feel like I could have done better.
I want to do that again. Yeah, retake.
No, we got it. We got it. We're going.
Okay, so very quickly, because I know we're kind of running out of time. The next 10 years, you think franchises, is that where you see the business going?
Absolutely, 100%. Franchise, giving other people who are just starting out the opportunity to run their own Black and Brass. We continue to grow wholesale. So restaurants, cafes, resorts, grocery outlets, you'll continue to see our products across the shelves, across the nation. And of course, our online business, blackandbrasscoffee.com. We roast and package basically to order. So everything that you're getting comes from our roastery. It's always fresh. It's always premium. Expect to see great things moving forward.
Looking forward to it. Thank you so much for being with us, Travis. This podcast was brought to you by A.M. Skyer, a third-generation family insurance business started in 1920. I'm Lisa Champeau. Thanks again, Travis.
Thank you, Lisa.
Talk to you next time.